Hi there, everybody. This is Val Cole. I want to welcome you all to the latest in our Park Bench chat series. I'm really glad that you could find time during the workday in a super busy time of year to join us. I am a member of one of TPL's advisory boards, which is a fancy way of saying I'm a volunteer. I've been involved with TPL as a volunteer for about 3 years, and I love the outdoors. I love all aspects of the outdoors, but since I've joined TPL, I've gotten particularly fired up about the kind of work that you just saw in that video. Giving everybody in our country access to quality outdoor space. That video always leaves me a little bit of emotional, and it's super topical now more than ever. I'm sure all of you have found refuge in parks during this super challenging year for all of us. But during the pandemic, it's really been a lifeline almost, the thing that keeps us sane in many cases. In case you didn't know it, over half of all vigorous exercise, heart healthy exercise, takes place in parks near your home, which is great if you have one near your home. People who work out in parks are also less likely to get sick. But as you saw from that video, sadly, 100 million people in this country, including 28 million children, don't have access to a quality park or open space near their home. It's kind of a hard thing for most of us to imagine, not having that access. Even more troubling, with some data that we released this summer, is the news that parks that serve primarily American Indian, Asian, Black, Hispanic, and Pacific Islander populations are half the size and serve five times as many people as those that are in the neighborhoods of Anglo-Americans. Like, let that sink in. It's just an astounding figure when you think of it. For most of us who are able to take park access for granted, frankly. So today, I'm really pleased. I'm pleased to be here with three of our partners. We do lots of work with partners at TPL, and those partners are working with us to change that reality and give all Americans access to a quality park. We have with us, as I introduce them, Mr. Luis Benitez, the Vice President for Government Affairs and Global Impact at the VF Corporation. You may not know that name, but you definitely know their brands. They include esteemed outdoor brands such as JanSport, Timberland, and The North Face. I've also got being joined today by Sherry Carter, who is the Vice President of Boeing's Global Engagement. Sherry oversees all Boeing's global strategies for charitable giving and volunteerism. Boeing has been an active and generous supporter of TPL for well over 20 years, and we're happy to have them with us. And finally, I'm joined by Wendy Felice, who is the director of the Center for Inclusion and Belonging at the American Immigration Council and an adjunct professor of communications at Georgetown University. Wendy is also spearheading a national campaign that we're going to hear about a little bit more during the chat. So the way this is going to work is there's about 20 minutes of me asking the guests questions. It's pretty informal. All of you in the audience are also able to ask questions. And while I'm sure you're all proficient, maybe more than you want to be in Zoom at this point, I will just point out that use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen to ask a question. You can do that at any time. And then when the group is done doing Q&A amongst ourselves, we will open those questions up and take them. All right, well, I'm going to let it rip. I think I'll start with you today, Luis. And I want to start by saying thank you. The Equitable Communities Fund that you guys all the audience saw at the beginning of the video is a super important program that we begun. And the VF Corporation was our first corporate partner. So we want to thank you for that. And as far as a question, how about tell us about the umbrella of companies that you support, Luis, and how you think about creating equitable park and open space and why that's important to the VF brands.
Thanks, Val. And it's an honor to be here with Wendy and Cheryl and everybody else on this call. So I oversee government affairs and global impact for VF Corporation. And as you said, Val, we're a holding company for some of the world's most iconic outdoor industry apparel and footwear brands. We make fun stuff, let's just put it that way, and comfortable stuff that help people be more active and comfortable while they are outside pursuing their passions. But something that's really important to our, sorry?
Having fun is important.
Having fun is important. Well, and that sort of ties into the VF Foundation's work with the Trust for Public Lands. Obviously, you know, the foundation tries to support organizations in driving movements for the betterment of people and the planet. And it goes without saying that your introduction did most of the work with answering this question, that equitable access to the outdoors is something that we deeply believe in. And, you know, the rationale behind that, you know, we can talk about the economy that the outdoor industry drives. We can talk about the American jobs that the outdoor economy services. But when you talk about equitable access to the outdoors and being inspired and also being healthy, without that gateway basic level access, the rest of the stuff just doesn't work. And so we were really excited to partner with TPL, obviously, in this process. And believe it or not, our former governor here in Colorado, John Hickenlooper, also now our incoming senator, freshman senator, also believed in the same sort of ethic, that access to green space and to open space. So I think for us at VF, it's also, it's a philanthropic engagement, but it's also a policy engagement as well. It's something that we deeply believe in talking about and solidifying, not only fiscally for the betterment of our communities, but from a policy agenda as well, something that we always support taking a look at and keeping an eye on.
I like to say it's hard to become an environmentalist if you never have access to the outdoors. So with things like climate change and whatnot, if you never see anything but asphalt parking lots and chain link fences, it's hard for any of that to matter. So thanks for those comments. Sherry, Boeing has been a supporter of TPLs for well over 20 years. And a personal story I can tell is that I was with my teenage kids in Chicago 2 years ago and did not know a lot about TPL. And I took them on the 606 trail, that great rail trail that goes almost 3 miles in Chicago. And we did a lot of things on that trip, but they thought that was by far and away the coolest. And I know Boeing was a huge supporter of that. Tell us about your corporate responsibility priorities and how you view something like park equity and open space access as fitting into those.
Well, thank you, Val, and thanks everybody for the opportunity to be here. We have been a longtime partner of the Trust, and we are so very proud of that. So happy to be here today to represent so many at Boeing that believe in your efforts and our employees that want to support your efforts. So at Boeing, our charitable support and global engagement focuses on three different pillars, strategic pillars, our future, our heroes, and our homes. Over the years, we have fine-tuned our focus on giving to concentrate in those three areas. Our future focuses on STEM and education support. Our heroes pillar focuses on veterans and military families. And our homes focuses on our Boeing home communities where we live and work. Our focus on racial equity and social justice is overarching for all those three strategic pillars. And this important work and the environment and our support sits across all three of those pillars as well. But mostly it's part of our homes pillar and focuses on the communities that we work and live in. Over the past 5 years, Boeing has provided more than $30 million to environmental organizations throughout the world, areas like Utah, Washington State, and Japan. And this number comes from Boeing grants, sponsorships, and employee gifts and volunteer matching gifts. We also estimate that our Boeing employees have volunteered more than 60,000 hours with environmental organizations. So this work is part of the heart and soul of this company. In addition, we provide emergency response funds during times of tragedy like flooding and wildfires. And all of this work, I help lead and guide the team that actually does all the frontline work. It's all executed by an amazing team of community investors because we believe we are investing in the communities where we serve around the world. And I've asked one of them to join me on the virtual park bench today. Vanessa Smith is going to join me. She works on the ground for us in California. And I've asked her to share some of the examples of our meaningful investments. So Vanessa, welcome. Thanks for joining me and all of the group today.
Thank you, Sherry. And thank you everyone for making room for me on today's park bench. Really excited to be here. I just want to take a few moments to share some of the great examples of the work that we're doing in Southern California, specifically in two different communities. First is the city of Compton. The city of Compton is an underserved community, a community of color, and they only have 0.6 acres of park space open for the residents. There's a beautiful park that they built in response to the poor lack of space in the city. It's called the Compton Natural Creek Park. They have bridges and a walking path, an amphitheater, an educational garden. But at the beginning and the start of this year, that park was only open Monday through Friday for limited hours. Through our partnership and work with the LA Conservation Corps, that park is now open 7 days a week. Another example for the city of Compton that I like to share speaks for itself. The photo and the quote that you see before you is an example of a program that we supported with Nature Bridge to take students to open space. If we can't transform their local neighborhoods overnight, then let's give them access. And if you take a moment to read that quote from the student, I think that's our why. That's why we do the work that we do, for children to go up there and give that response on a survey program says a lot for us. Next picture, please. And now I'd like to talk about some of the work that we're doing with Trust for Public Land and in the city of Southgate. That's me right there on the right with one of my colleagues, Mark Taylor. We're out in this space that's adjacent to two main freeways. It's also adjacent to a mobile home park for seniors, many of them who live in poverty and are disabled. But as you can see, it's not a welcoming space. It's not open to the public right now. It's a good thing you can't see our faces because we probably weren't smiling because I remember it was a very hot day. There was no shade. And again, just unused space. Next photo, please. And this is what that space will now become because of the partnerships and the work with Trust for Public Land. I can probably spend the next 20 minutes just talking about this great work, but I get the chills just looking at this and thinking of what that space will become because I envision grandparents from the mobile park taking their grandchildren, sitting underneath in a tree in the orchard, picking some fruit, spending the day there, going to the community park. And projects like this transforms not just the space, but the community as a whole. And that's why we do what we do. Back to you, Sherry.
Thank you, Vanessa. We are so proud of this partnership, Val, and I look forward to many more years together. So back to you. Thanks for the question and the opportunity.
Thanks. Well, you never know who's going to drop by when you're sitting on a park bench. So that was a bit of a surprise, but Vanessa, super awesome. I think you know, it's real easy to sort of think about environmental work as saving the coastline or redwoods or preserving mountainous areas, all of which is super, super important. I think all of us at TPL believe that. But the kind of work that she was showing there of what I would call bringing nature into communities that don't have any is super important. And I personally am not aware of any organization, any other nonprofit that's doing that kind of work at a national level. And it's
transformational, that's for sure.
Yep. You're giving these communities something to be proud of. It was cool to see. Wendy, you're still out there. We'd like to get to you. Earlier this year, you joined an effort, we joined an effort, that you're spearheading called the Inclusion Innovation Collaborative that has lots of other well-known nonprofits like the YMCA in it. Next month, my understanding is you're going to launch a national campaign. Tell us a little bit about it and how you view the role of parks and open spaces within that campaign.
My pleasure, Val. Thank you, everyone, for welcoming me to the park bench with you all. I'm a big fan of the Trust for Public Land, and I'm really grateful to be here with all of you. Bienvenidos a todos. Actually, last week we launched Belonging Begins With Us. And Belonging Begins With Us is a national public service campaign that is being brought to you by the Ad Council that you guys remember from Smokey the Bear days. And what Belonging Begins With Us is, it's a national public service campaign that is asking everyone in America to think a little more deeply about who you include and who you exclude in your daily life. And so with that message, we knew we needed a companion program in communities. And so Trust for Public Land, along with the YMCA and several other leading national nonprofits, are working with us to bring this campaign to life in communities. Trust for Public Land was obviously such a great partner because you guys have Parks Unite Us and your effort to create more equitable communities and ensuring all communities have access to green space and parks is really key, because we just know you need the park, you need the structure, right? And you also need programming that allow people to feel like they're part of that park, that they're part of that community, that they have ownership over it, that they feel welcome and they belong. And TPL has actually led the way in developing some really terrific programming where communities of color start to feel part of that park, owning that park, participating in that park, being part of the park. And so we're really excited to continue to build out work in community through this inclusion work attached to the Belonging Begins With Us campaign. And I just wanted to say, since we have so many wonderful corporate partners here, you know, we also thought about having corporate partnerships helping us build out this inclusion work in community. And just knowing who we wanted to reach in particular with our message, our automatic first stop was Walmart. And Walmart has been a really key partner in building out this inclusion work, because Walmart's in 5,000 communities. You know, you can't actually drive 10 miles without hitting a Walmart in most parts of the country. And so, you know, one thing I would urge people is obviously think about the corporate partners who will serve the audiences and get you to the people you're trying to get to with your message and your program. Don't just think about them as resources, financial resources. Obviously, financial resources are good. We all need that to run our nonprofit programs. But also think about their consumers. Think about their employees, right? These are also powerful networks that you can work your strategies and your programming into. So, I just wanted to give that little plug to Walmart, because they really have decided that they want to be a really connected partner in community, and not just be a store in community, but really be a place where people can come together and we can advance change. So I'm very excited about it. I'm very excited about the partnership with Trust for Public Land. And I'll give it back to you, Val.
Thanks, Wendy. Gracias por sus palabras. Luis, jumping back to you for a minute. How is it that the VF brands, and you could either speak about them through the foundation or the individual brands that we might recognize, how are they addressing social responsibility? How are they thinking about it? How are they choosing to make decisions on who, what organizations and where they're going to focus their efforts?
Yeah, no, Val, that's a great question. Because obviously, you know, as a holding company, you know, our brands all have their own unique cultures and identities. And the last thing we ever want to do is impose on their processes or the things that are really important to them. And instead, what we kind of look for is that collective middle ground. So the things that we can all agree on that we sort of spring forward from. And so the places where we kind of all align kind of fall under three distinct territories. So the first one, which I would argue that parks close to home falls underneath, would be what we call outside matters. So it's sort of protecting those outside spaces, increasing participation and access, and championing environmental sustainability. And then the next section that we tend to focus on is what we call worthy work, which involves a lot of closing the skills gap. Obviously, we are a collection of makers within our brands, and education looks very different for a maker than it does a more traditional educational path. So it's really about championing education overall, but restoring the value of some of those trades that we find deeply important to us as a community of brands. And then the last sort of bucket that we tend to focus on that I'll give you a funny story with one of our brands is what we call free to be. And really what free to be is about in the concept and the context of D&I is fostering individual creativity, encouraging those pursuit of passions through that creative expression, and embracing that inclusion and diversity via those human empowerment moments and depending on the organization, those organizational development opportunities. So one of our brands, The North Face, which is global and pretty iconic, actually had a program with all of you at TPL, the Boulder Project, where we wanted to place small, for those of you on the call that aren't climbers, small bouldering boulders, meaning an artificial boulder that you can just scramble around on and learn the movement of rock climbing and sort of some of the basics of rock climbing. And it's definitely a sport that from an urban engagement environment is not something that you see all that much other than indoor climbing gyms that depending on where you are, you may or may not have access to, and definitely not outside. And so the North Face built this whole campaign around some of these initiatives. And they contextualized it with the phrase, walls are meant for climbing, and put t-shirts together in three different languages and a bunch of different products right about the time that the immigration conversation came along. And Wendy and I, you know, we were having a good chuckle about this as we were prepping for this call, that when it comes to brands, you know, it's no longer enough to just make a quality product. You now have to stand for something behind that product. And I don't, as a matter of fact, I know North Face's goal was not to engage in an immigration conversation. Their goal was to engage in the fact that, you know, when you have personal challenges that you could be self-identify as walls, you find a way to get over them. And then they tried to contextualize that through spending time outside, being active outdoors. In the context of these boulder initiatives in urban parks. And you know, the connectivity and the thread that came from that with everything else that was going on in our country was really extraordinary to watch. And I think, you know, a brand's choice, regardless of how big or small that brand is, regardless of it's someone like Boeing with Sherry or an apparel or footwear brand like us, you really have to make some of those conscious choices that regardless of how uncomfortable the conversation could be, if it's something that you believe in at your core and is connected to your mission, your vision, and your values, then you have to be a part of the conversation. So, you know, that's just an example of how North Face took a really unique opportunity to engage in a much deeper national conversation.
Wow, that's a interesting story. Whoever came up with the name of the campaign must have been doing backflips at some point with all the extra attention you guys got.
It was a pretty interesting time around the shop, that's for sure.
I bet. So you have got an interesting background in that you're currently in the private sector, you've previously been in the nonprofit sector, and also in public service. You've been in all three sides of the triangle, so to speak. For what kind of advice would you have for the companies that might be out here in the audience today in terms of how they should think about demonstrating their core values that you talked about as it, and in this case, as it relates to racial equity and environmental equity?
You know, I think Sherry gave a great example from Boeing, and Vanessa sort of, you know, outlined that it really has to happen at the ground game level. And this isn't something that you can just bring philanthropic dollars to the table and think that it's going to be enough. I would challenge folks on the call that are thinking about this to really look at it in a couple of different ways. One, you have to decide what aligns with who you are as an organization. Because trying to be everything to everybody within your community has a tendency to dilute your process. So you really don't have a chance to go as deep as you could potentially with certain organizations. Without making some of those critical choices, because that also involves saying no to people that, you know, we do this, but we don't do that. So being really intentional about where it is you want to drive impact. And then once you make those decisions, understand that this is not a short game. This is a long haul endeavor that once you cross that threshold, community partners will see you as a community member. And if you want to really drive impact and be a deeply connected part of that process, you have to show up like any other community member would, committed and invested, and with the understanding that this isn't just a one-time thing, that you have to be able to see things through, not only to completion, but also to understand what comes next and to be a part of that larger conversation. So those would really be the key elements that I think would be worth considering if organizations on the call are looking at this as a potential avenue.
What I hear you saying is not just about writing the check and moving on. It's really leaning into whatever that cause is and staying with it. Cool. That's really helpful. I actually would like to turn back to Sherry for a second. You also have been are in the private sector, and we're in the nonprofit sector. How do you think about Boeing's corporate social responsibility today? In particular with the things that Vanessa was showing, the focus on equity, because I can imagine some people out in the audience are saying, oh, it's not intuitive to me that Boeing would be in support of parks and open space. I think they support airports or something else. So give us your thoughts on that.
Well, thanks for raising that. I think a couple of things. You know, I have been mostly on the public sector and nonprofit side most of my career. So this opportunity with Boeing really came out of the blue for me just a year ago. And it really has been a dream come true for me, because I always thought during those years how nice it would be to be on the other side of the table. But for more reasons than you would think. I mean, to have the opportunity to lead a team of community investors that live in those communities, have the knowledge, the frontline knowledge of what's important to those communities and our employees, is really the ideal situation for me. You know, this year has been one that no one expected to come our way. I was just 5 months into my new role when we were hit with a pandemic. Then a couple of months later, our work to address racial inequities in our country was intensified. And Boeing is really focused on racial equity and social justice for many years, but this time has truly focused our work. And it's really intensified our work and our partnership with our employees around these issues as well. You know, I think flexibility is important, Val. As a company, I know that's a hard word to kind of to understand, but we really are flexible. We're also open for new ideas. We're always thinking about what our community investors come to the table with that may be outside the box. But we really do focus on those strategic pillars. That's our guidepost. Because those are really important issues for the company and our leadership and our communities and our employees. So we really try to stay within those parameters as much as we can. But you have to be nimble and flexible as well. And we have found this year to be an important year to be flexible and to be able to answer the needs of communities. I just wanted to also talk about one other opportunity that came our way this year, and we intensified our work with Native Americans and tribal nations. We've done a lot of partnership with the nations in the past, but this year it came to our attention in a really intensified way. And so we've done a lot of work to think about what we can do with them in the future. And one article that I want to share with everyone that really popped up just a few weeks ago in the Post, Washington Post on November 24th, talked about an ancient people with a modern climate plan. And it talks about Washington state tribes that are addressing they're working together to restore the salmon habitat in northwestern Washington. Because of course they rely on fish, but not only for their diet, but it's also part of their culture. And we've paid special attention to this, that was brought to our attention in an article that I was reading in the Washington Post. They've been focusing on this effort since 2006 after a brutal storm really brought this to the fore for them. That's where the long game comes in. That's where our flexibility to identify partnerships that we really need to focus on quickly to become a long-time partner. Those are the things that I think companies really have to do this day and time. You can't always be strict in your thinking. You have to have flexibility. You have to be nimble. And that's why our model of community investors all over the world bringing great ideas and great opportunities to the table really works for us. You know, I always say that, I mean, there's so much that we can do, so much more we can do. We need to listen and ask ourselves, what do our partners need from us? We do a lot of conversations about our partners, and that's on the local level as well. And I firmly believe corporations must lead by example. They need to set the example and ask ourselves, if not us, then who? Our Boeing environmental investments support communities for the long term, and we believe will impact generations for years to come. And we're really proud of what we're doing and really always thinking about what's next for us.
Thanks, Sheer. Those are some great stories. And I'll just say we're honored to be one of those partners in it for the long haul with you. we're about ready to start the Q&A, but I've got from the audience, but I've got one more question myself to ask Wendy. As we all know, it's been clear through the pandemic that parks and places keep us connected to each other. Given what you do, I just wondered if you might have some factoids or statistics that you've seen on the value of parks and open spaces in terms of social cohesion and community inclusion.
Oh, that's a really good question. And that's actually like the million-dollar question, is how do you actually evaluate social cohesion? How do you actually evaluate the impact of programs that build bridges across differences? And make people feel more included. So I think that's honestly a work in progress. I think there's great data about people's health, obviously having much better outcomes when you're more connected out in public life and exercising. But actually deeper than that is this emotional connection that people have. You know, we have a deep-seated psychological need to belong, to be connected to each other, to have relationships, and not to be alone. And so sort of people's ability, I know for myself, just to be able to walk out of my house and see other human beings in the park. I have a beautiful trail behind my home in Washington, DC. It connects you to your neighbors. It allows you to say hi. I spend a lot of time visiting with the dogs in the park. You know, like this keeps my mental health in a better place than it would be if I was just alone all the time. And so I think there's just like, we've come to so deeply appreciate the ability to get outside during this pandemic and to be able to go into our parks and at least see our neighbors, at least see our community, even from a distance. I can't think of a time that it's been more clear to me than during this pandemic. And I think we don't take enough time to measure the sort of psychological, the spiritual impact that having places to go in nature, being able to connect to one another, how important that is. And, you know, I read a great article about what they call it in Japan, they call it tree bathing. So I always tell people I'm going out for my tree bathing, right? And I walk through the forest and I bathe in the trees. And it really does center me. And I even do some of my best sort of thinking, work thinking, just walking away from my desk and being under the shade of all the trees. So I think people will start to think a lot more about how do you measure the social psychological impact of being out in nature and being able to see people in your community. So I love that. And I look forward to doing more of that kind of work.
Thank you for those comments. I thought I was going out for a walk later this afternoon, but I guess I'm going for a tree bath. Well, we've got a lot of questions rolling in. So I'm going to turn it over to Cheryl, the question goddess from TPL. And just remember, if you haven't entered a question yet, you can pop one in at the bottom of your screen. So Cheryl, over to you.
Thanks, Val. This question is for the panel. I'd love to hear how panelists are sharing messages with their employees about the importance of parks, given so many urgent priorities this year, pandemic and social justice movements, for instance.
Well, you know, I'll kind of speak to that through the lens of my old job working for our former governor. My job was to oversee the outdoor industry office for the state of Colorado. And we kind of codified the impacts of the outdoor industry in four pretty specific lanes: environmental impact, conservation and stewardship, education and workforce development, and public health. And so I think the making the case for why this is still important, especially now, is that this isn't the connectivity to public health and green space and access to that green space is no longer anecdotal. It is backed up by hard math, hard data truly indicates that, you know, now more than ever, this is necessary for not only our mental well-being, but our recovery on the other side of the pandemic. You know, Wendy mentioned forest bathing coming out of Japan, and the reality with that process and mechanism is now that there's over 10 countries globally where a doctor can actually prescribe forest bathing instead of a course of medication. And these are not small countries engaged in weird medical practices. These are actually sanctioned medical professionals that that can now prescribe forest bathing instead of a course of medicine. Here in the United States, the data is coming from our returning veteran population in the context of PTSD and traumatic brain injuries. We have quantifiable data that proves that spending time outside changes your brain chemistry. So in the context of why this is still important through my lens, both in my prior work and my current work, the public health conversation is front and center.
And Cheryl, I'll just add, our community investors are not just really bringing great ideas to the table, but they're also great storytellers. And they're telling stories of our partners and our partner organizations and the impact that we're having in the communities every day to our employees through several different tools. And Vanessa in particular and her team in California talk a lot about this work and this partnership and our newsletters. I mean, we have timely reports and stories and loads of photos. We really believe in telling the story of these investments we're making and also linking our employees up to great projects to volunteer and to give contributions themselves. So really a lot of ours, all of ours, is through our community investors around the world.
Thank you. The next question is also for the panel. Would any of the corporate partners speak to their employee engagement and or volunteer-based work in communities across America? And what lessons did you learn from that?
Luis, you want me to go first?
Sure, Tad,
I mean, we have a very robust employee engagement program around the world. That has been the cornerstone really of our corporate social engagement and throughout the years. When I joined a year ago, I was totally in awe of the work that's being done by our employees on the ground. They own these partnerships. They feel responsible for these partnerships. And I think, you know, if there's any difficulty that we have, it's getting the word out more widely and more deeply within our base around the world. We're working each and every day on ideas and communication strategies and campaigns that we can come up with to do our internal communication better. You can never do enough. And so that's really something that we work on each and every day.
You know, and for us, at least in the context of the foundation, and you know, Val, you mentioned this earlier, for us, it's not just about the fiscal donation. It's also about the engagement that our associates can have on the other side of that donation. We have a pretty robust volunteerism program that only in the past 2 years have we consolidated our brand's footprints and moved our headquarters from North Carolina to Denver. And really one of the reasonings behind that is because we have such an engaged community of associates that really do want to spend time within the community. communities that we serve. So, you know, I think for us, it's as much about the partnership through the foundation as it is about the longer term engagement of giving back to our communities.
Thank you. This next question is for Wendy. As a lifelong outdoors person, I am still so very amazed when others seem surprised to see me enjoying the great outdoors, our parks, streams, and mountains. What are your thoughts on that non-welcoming response, possibly being one of the causes of lower numbers of Hispanics and Latinos and African Americans historically spending less time in the great outdoors?
Oh, thank you for that question. That's such an important, it's an important thing for us to discuss. So look, it's about culture, right? So we can build places where people can come together, but there can be a culture, right? That's an active culture in a country, in a community. So people of color will very quickly get the message that they're not welcome in that park, that they're not welcome in that place. If they are harassed, obviously, if they are, you know, even given to these sort of looks, right? People get the message very clearly. And so we have to build the spaces, but you have to create the programs that help develop a particular culture. So I'll point to one project that the Trust for Public Land has been working on in Chattanooga by a TPL staff member named Daniela Peterson. And she recognized that that local park was a place where the Latino community did not feel welcome. They did not feel like it was their park, as well as the African American community. So what she did was develop relevant programming that would invite people into the park. And what she did was a family picture day, because that's a very traditional thing we do in Latino homes, is we do this sort of annual photograph of the family. So she developed a picture day or a series of picture days that allowed families to come into the park and have their pictures taken. And so what you do is you have to create these programs and this culture where people start to say, this is my park, this is where I come, this is where I can belong, this is where I can do my barbecues, my kids' birthday parties, and start to feel comfortable there. That's a lot of work. That's the hardcore organizing work that the Trust for Public Land is doing and will have to continue to do in these parks so people can feel like they have ownership over that park, so that they feel welcome in that park. And then the work we're trying to build out with the Belonging Begins With Us campaign is how do we also build it so communities are crossing differences and getting to know each other in that park, so everyone feels like they belong in that park. Because if one dominant group feels that over another, then you kind of continue to run into that space. So I think we really want parks to be places where people come together to solve common problems, to do common community projects that benefit everyone. Everyone's on equal footing and they're building a community space for everyone. And so that's also really important in the development of these parks, is that everyone who's part of that community is part of building that space. We're co-creating, right? That's the buzzword, but it's real. You have to co-create spaces, because if one group developed it for another group, they don't know if that group got all of their needs taken care of. So really, in building out parks and programming, it's a lot of co-creation that we have to do with everybody across the community. That doesn't solve, you know, 400 years of systemic racism, right? It doesn't, but there are things that we have the power to do that we can start working on, that hopefully start to correct some of the historic wrongs that have been done, but that's through very, very thoughtful, intentional programming across the community. And I think TPL's already got some of that work that's very, very exciting that they're piloting in different parks across the country.
Thank you, Wendy. Val, this next question is for you. I love all the work to develop new public spaces to serve communities more equitably, but that can take several years. What programs or partnerships have you partnered with to get currently park-starved communities to existing parks and open spaces that may just be a few miles away, but difficult for all to access?
Yeah, it's a good question, because particularly if you look at cities, all the land is occupied already. And, you know, buying a square mile of property is, you know, in many cases prohibitively expensive. There's a lot that TPL does. That project Vanessa showed that Boeing's involved in with us, the creating a park in, you know, what I'll just call severely underused space is something we often try and do. But I think the sort of what I would call our signature program along those lines is one that I've been associated with called Green Schoolyards. I'm here in the Bay Area, and I got real involved last year in a pilot project with the Oakland Public School System, where we in partnership with the school system, and five schools are taking what are essentially asphalt parking lots with chain link fences and a couple of basketball hoops and completely transforming those under the guidance of the community, often the students, the teachers, the surrounding communities, and if you will, rebirthing those as green schoolyards with community gardens, lots of trees, play structures that are environmentally friendly. And I just toured one actually last week, and it's astounding. So we're taking something without buying any land and completely transforming it for the students. But then this, what I'd call the special secret sauce, is that we also struck an agreement with the Oakland Unified School District that when the school day is done, that's a park for everybody. And I have toured these sites, and believe me, there is nothing nearby that these folks have to feel good about or to get exercise or just peace. And so without buying any land and being very creative and partnering with the school district, we've completely transformed schoolyards for the students, but then also done something for the community. And while my familiarity is in Oakland, where we really got started was with the Bloomberg administration in New York City, where they have created 200, that's two with two zeros, 200 green schoolyards that are all parks for these communities. And they're in places where people don't have other options. So I think that kind of philosophy really, to me, it makes TPL really stand out, for one thing. It's a very pragmatic approach. My background is in sales and marketing, and I think you have to think super creatively about how you're going to get parks in places where they don't have them, when there's warehouses and factories and houses and all sorts of things around already. So the Green Schoolyards program is certainly, I would say, embodies our way of thinking creatively of putting parks nearby, near people where they haven't had them.
Thank you, Val. This next one is for you as well. Can you talk a little bit about TPL's corporate partnership program, and how do you feel about corporate advertising in parks in exchange for donations?
Wow, I'm a volunteer. I'm not sure if I'm technically adept at it. I would almost ask someone from the TPL staff to jump in on that, because I don't know the answer, to be honest, in terms of advertising. But I would say in terms of corporate work, I've had the opportunity to engage with a number of corporations. Last week, I was speaking with a CEO of a large bank on the East Coast that's super invested in Buffalo, and they believe making the community a healthier and more prosperous place is part of what they're supposed to do, not just take people's money and keep it in bank accounts. So I think there's lots of room for companies to be involved, and it's a real positive thing. And as you heard Sherry mention, they're impatient, which is a really good thing. They want to get things done quick. That is very helpful often. I like to say land preservation is forever, but it sometimes feels like it takes forever too. As far as advertising, I'm going to opt out on that because I'm not an employee and I really don't know what TPL's position is.
Thanks, Val. Luis, this question is for you. For a mountain town with extensive public lands and outdoor recreation, what risks exist for the community were it to closely link its economic future to its public lands?
Boy, yeah, that is an age-old question that I think goes all the way back to even before President Roosevelt's time. This concept of conservation, I wouldn't say versus stewardship, but in conjunction with stewardship. In small mountain communities, looking through the lens of a diversified economy and a goal towards a diversified economy can often lead you to some pretty distinct choices. I think here in Colorado, I'll give our West Slope as an example, which what that means is sort of the western part of our state. We're very, very heavily dependent on the extractive industries, the oil and gas industry, for a majority of the fiscal strength of the region, but job creator, the employment, the whole nine yards. And seeing as that industry historically has always been on a boom bust cycle, you know, the real effort was, well, how do we look through the lens of diversifying our economy first and treat those public lands the same way we would any other natural resource that we have to protect, promote, preserve, and defend all at the same time. And so I think if you look through that lens of, you know, the creation of the utilization of the public land as a community resource is fully acceptable. But along with the utilization has to come this plan of overwatch as well. And the best example I'll give you, and it's a very personal one, when I served on the town council in Eagle, Colorado, it was a 7,500 person community then. And what, you know, obviously with a very limited budget, and we were due for a new sewage treatment facility because our town was growing. But yet there was this growing recreational voice that was clamoring for mountain biking trail development in the community. And the argument there was that with a more robust trail system, we could draw tourists from up valley. We could also host mountain bike races. So it would be a Main Street economic development driver as well, which would in turn increase our tax base, which would in turn get us to that sewage treatment facility payoff a little bit quicker. Now, the hard part when you have limited dollars is how do you make those decisions as a community and as leadership of a community? And I'll tell you, we went with the mountain biking trail development, and it was a tough one. There were a lot of citizens in the community that said, your priorities are in the wrong place because you're going to build those trails. How are you going to overwatch those trails? There's no guarantee that tourists will come. And if they do, there's no guarantee they're going to stop for dinner and stay in a hotel. But fortunately for us, this story has a happy ending. We managed to secure the high school mountain biking championships quite a few years in a row that brought communities and teams to town. And we were seen as a destination with equitable access where the youth of the community, diverse youth of the community, were just as engaged as the adults. But I think, you know, that's a really long-winded way of saying when it comes to making these choices as a rural community and as a small community, perfectly acceptable to see it as a resource that you can utilize, but you have to have a program of overwatch and stewardship directly in parallel with the development plan as well.
Great. Thank you, Luis. That's all the time we have for questions. So I'm going to hand it over to you, Val, for closing.
Thanks. I enjoyed that story, Luis, as a mountain biker. Well, we're just about at the end of the hour, everyone. And, you know, if you look at the history of our country, inequitable access to resources has resulted in a really strong divide between the haves and the have-nots. These are solvable problems, but they require thinking, engagement, effort to broaden the voices of people who are at the table and bring change. If I could lob one final question out to any or all of the panelists briefly, would be, do you have any final thoughts for our audience on really how companies can lean in and play their part to move society forward?
Well, you know, I would just say being there. Being there when the community has a need, being there when the country has a need, and being there when our employees have needs. We're really focused on the needs of our communities. And I would just say being there is the most important, being present and listening.
Showing up.
I would say, you know, I would just echo showing up. And then I would also say, making that engagement exceptional, realizing that there are different ways to look at things, and don't see that corporate partner as a scary thing. 9 times out of 10, corporations are hungry for those partnerships and those community engagements. So never see it as an intimidating thing to reach out and make that engagement exceptional.
Wendy? Yeah, I'll just add on from the other side, being out, you know, in a nonprofit, you know, treat corporate partners like people like you would treat any other relationship. Don't just go for them to them for money. Go to them and invite them to your events, be friends, update them on your program activities. Tell them, you know, what you guys are thinking about. Treat them like you'd treat any other partner in your work ahead. I found it to be really gratifying to build those relationships with people who can sort of partner with you and help advance the cause through the lens of corporate giving. They have access to people we don't and partnerships we don't. And so, and then the other thing is, if I would also think about corporate philanthropy, there's really wonderful corporate foundations supporting community-based work. So also think of the business side, but also think of the philanthropic arm of the corporation if there is one.
Right on. Great comments, you guys. I've enjoyed hearing from you as well. Well, I want to thank all of you that took time out of your day to hang in there with us. I hope it was informative and stimulating. Just know that your support and in many cases your partnership means a lot to us at TPL. We've got a lot of ways for you to engage with us. The Equitable Communities Fund is one, but there are many. We're good at partnering and always welcome engaging with new organizations. I believe there's a link posted on the screen and some info about where you can find details on upcoming chats. And again, thanks for your involvement, your interest. Stay safe, and we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.